I would say, if I could boil it down to one thing, it's that the lung wall is stuck to the chest wall. Okay? That's the most important thing. Chest wall is your ribs and intercostal muscles and all the other things that are on your chest wall. The lung is the lung that we just talked about. They're stuck to each other. One way to think of it is the chest wall holds the lung out. Or vice versa. The lung wall holds the chest in. Just a different way of saying the same thing, that they're stuck to each other. But it's not a direct attachment. They kind of connect through the pleural membranes, the pleural cavities. That's what I say here. The interaction of lungs and chest wall is not by direct attachment, but through the pleural cavity, a fluid-filled space between the parietal and visceral pleura. I do want you to know the pleural membranes. Because the lungs and thoracic wall, like I said, chest wall, because they pull away from each other on opposite sides of the pleural cavity, the intrapleural pressure is less than atmospheric pressure. Let's note some things. First of all, the pleural cavities. Well, we should talk about the pleural cavity by talking about the pleural membranes. The parietal pleura, as well as the visceral pleura. There's something that's called the three P's of anatomy. The pericardium, the pleura, and the peritoneum. The linings of different things. Pericardium lines, you know, we studied it. It's the lining of the heart, yes. And the peritoneum lines the body cavity, and the pleura are basically, they enclose the space for the lungs. The parietal pleura is basically on the inside of the chest wall. Lines inside of chest wall or thorax. The visceral pleura, it's on the lung. Okay. I'll say intimate with lung wall. And they're stuck to each other through these pleural membranes. So in between them is the pleural cavity. The pleural cavity when we're talking about a sliver of a space, a millimeter, and it's shown here, pleural cavity between the pleura. There. I'll say space between. Space between the pleura, both of them, the parietal and the visceral. And it's fluid filled. What I say on here, because the lung is stuck to the chest and they're kind of like pulling on each other, it creates a negative pressure on the inside of this cavity with respect to atmospheric pressure. So let's first talk about that. Atmospheric pressure is the air we're breathing here at sea level in Sacramento. There is an atmosphere of air on top of you. Here's you, here's me drawing you, little stick figure, right? You live under a column of air all the way to outer space. That's the atmosphere. When we say one atmosphere pushing down on your body surface, About 760 millimeters of mercury. That's one atmosphere of pressure at sea level. Okay. So that's the air we breathe. Okay. That pressure is the pressure in the pleural cavity is negative with respect to this pressure, about 756. Call it intrapleural pressure. Call it 756 millimeters of mercury. I mean, it changes with breathing, but on average, it's negative relative to atmospheric pressure. Sometimes people call atmospheric pressure just zero. Make that the baseline. Therefore, what would intrapleural pressure be? Negative 4. But that's important. This is the negative pressure that's keeping lung stuck to the chest. If you break that seal, lung collapses. Difficult to inflate a deflated lung. Okay. So imagine that your lungs are always stuck to your chest, and every time you breathe air into it, it's like you're inflating an already inflated balloon. Much easier to do that than to inflate a balloon that's completely deflated, right? And I have a picture here of the pleura. The picture on the right here, you see like the blue area outlining the pink area? The pink area is more or less the lungs themselves. But you can see that the pleura, blue, occupy more space than the lungs themselves. So there's some little pleural recesses there. This picture here shows you how the pleural membranes are like the pericardial membranes. Lollipop lung, insert into this balloon filled with fluid. That's kind of a nice model of pleura around the lung. Much like here. Here's the lung and there's a small space between it. Your rib cage, your chest wall, just ribs and intercostal muscle. Let's advance the slide. Here's what happens if you break that seal. You get a collapsed lung. Fancy way of saying it is secondary atelectasis, collapsed lung. Wound breaks the seal. In this case, it's a bullet wound. When you break the seal, air or blood will rush into the pleural cavity, and the pressure equalizes, then there's nothing keeping the lung stuck to chest and it deflates. Okay. I'll write that down. So that pressure is very important. It's kind of like if you took two glass plates, and if you put a small drop on one plate and then put the two plates together, you could slide the plates like this, side to side. But if you tried to pull the plates apart, it would be very difficult because of the cohesive forces of water stuck in between the two plates. That's kind of the analogy that's given. But you can break that seal.
Professor?
Yeah.
I don't understand the zero mercury level.
Okay. Sometimes physiologists don't like to keep saying 760, comparing it to this. So they just call it zero.
So it'll still be 760 though.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll just set it at zero.
Oh.
So that way, if we say, okay, this is negative 4, 4 less than atmospheric pressure, you know it's 756.
Okay.
Any other questions? Yeah, so I know you don't think of it. You don't think of the air pressing on your body, but that's they call that pressure on the body surface. The air is pushing on you. Right? You don't think of it, but it's there, atmospheric pressure. So let's say bullet wound. In this example, they say air rushes in. I'll say it punctures pleura. basically you have a hole in your chest. Air rushes in to the pleural cavity. The pressure equalizes. The pressure goes from -4 to 0. Okay. Now that pressure equalizing breaks the seal, and that leads to collapsed lung. If air rushes in, that's called a pneumothorax. If blood rushes in, it's called a hemothorax. Collapsed lung. You can treat it by inserting a chest tube. I watched the paramedic students practice on cadavers. They just call it needle decompression. They literally just stick a needle of the syringe in the intercostal space somewhere. The clinician, you know, the paramedic tells you the best spots to do it. Because you should hear a popping sound or something, right? You should like let that air out. There are kinds of these pneumothoraxes that are like emergencies, like you have to decompress in the field. There's one that's called a tension pneumothorax with rightward shift. Shifting a heart. Let's say you have a pneumothorax on this side. There's a kind of pneumothorax that builds pressure, where the wound creates a flap. Normally, if you have a hole in your chest, you breathe in, breathe out, air can enter, air can exit. But if you create a flap, and when you breathe in, air can get in, but then you breathe out, closes the flap, air can't escape, it starts to build tension in the thorax.
Is that tension, and then the last word,
Is
that, is there a
missing letter? Yeah, I should have, right. Tension, pneumothorax. Tension, pneumo, oh my gosh. Pneumo, that's right, pneumo. Pneumo, is that how you spell
the
pneumo?
The tension is fension, or is it tension?
Oh, that's it, yeah. This is do over.
I think they're talking about the last word of the sentence.
And the last word is...
Oh my god. Shift is like the tension builds here, it crushes the heart, and it actually shifts it to the right. That could put a kink in the artery, and that's not good. Okay, so that one you want to decompress in the field. Okay. They have a figure in the book about the collapsed lung, shown on the bottom there. And they use the 0, -4 thing. Say it's 0 inside the lung, 0 outside, knife wound, and then something enters the space, the cavity. And here you can see when it equalizes 0, and the outside is 0, the seal breaks, the lung collapses. It's difficult to inflate that lung. Now the pleural cavities are separate, okay? So the other lung should keep you alive. And you can reinflate that they have gone to the hospital by the insertion of a chest tube. All right, so the mechanics of breathing, you know the pleura, and also know the muscles of breathing. We'll start with The main muscle of inspiration, diaphragm. I just put all the pictures that are good to look at for the diaphragm, a big dome-shaped muscle. The main muscle of inspiration. Okay, so the diaphragm has a central tendon. Here's an inferior view, looking up into the diaphragm. This is actually a large space. And look how high up the diaphragm goes into the thoracic cavity. So all the muscle fibers are arranged in a circle around the central tendon. And so when all the muscle fibers of the diaphragm contract, it pulls it down. So when the diaphragm contracts, it flattens. And that difference is shown blue versus red contracting, okay? Now what that does is, if you look at the red area, it's increasing the thoracic volume. That'll help draw air into your lungs. You increase the thoracic volume, you decrease the intra-alveolar pressure. Increase thoracic volume, decrease, call it intrapulmonary pressure. Basically to fill the vacuum. You breathe by creating this negative pressure inside your lung. So it's very important that you increase the volume of it. So also know the central tendon and all these important structures that go through the diaphragm there. Let me outline. There's the diaphragm, no central tendon. And know the three basically holes in there. There's a hole for the aorta, the inferior vena cava, and the esophagus. The hole for the inferior vena cava is the caval opening. It's at about the level of T8. The opening for the aorta is the aortic hiatus. At about the level of T12. Kind of midway in between those is the opening for the esophagus, the esophageal hiatus. Around T10. So there's the caval opening, the opening for the aorta, the opening for the aorta is here. That's the esophageal opening. Okay, so to look from the side view, right here. There's up at the highest one, that's inferior vena cava going through. At the mid-level, that's esophagus, going right through there is the aorta. Here's a picture of other muscles to help you breathe. The other main muscle of inspiration along with diaphragm is the external intercostals. Write that down. External intercostals are other. Main muscle of inspiration. Deep to that are the internal intercostals. They assist in forceful expiration, breath out. Assist in forceful expiration. So inspiration, breath in, expiration, breath out. You breathe in, you breathe out. You usually don't have to use muscles for breathing out. Normal quiet breathing, as you're all doing now, there's no muscle recruitment. Only for inspiration is there always muscle recruitment. And that is diaphragm external intercostals. Now, any muscle that attaches to the rib can be considered an accessory muscle of breathing. But those are the main ones. Any muscle with rib attachments. Is an accessory muscle of breathing. Accessory meaning not the main one. Now I'm not going to list them all on the board, but we usually teach them in 4:30. For example, well, I taught you one already. All the scalenes, these three here, which have attachments to rib 1 and 2, they can help you breathe. Sternocleidomastoid can. Pec major and minor. The serratus anterior, just to name a few. They all have attachments to rib and can potentially help you breathe. And when the chest expands and collapses, well, we want students to know how. Now, the pump handle movement describes how the chest expands from front to back. The sternal angle in your sternum acts kind of like a pump handle. It kind of like pivots just a little bit anterior and posterior. So look from overhead, the chest kind of like puffs up a little bit more at the sternal angle. Okay, so let me write that down. So the pump handle, basically what you got, it's movement at the sternal angle. And what the picture is showing you, this is how the chest, how the thorax expands from front to back, from anterior to posterior. The other one, the bucket handle movement, your rib is like a bucket handle. When you lift all the ribs together, well, they just kind of look at one. You just lift the bucket handle up a little bit. And when you do that, you expand the thorax laterally. technically that would be movement at the costal vertebral joints, how the rib is attached to the vertebra posteriorly. So I'll say movement at costo-vertebral joints. And this is basically describing how the thorax expands from side to side laterally. All right, so now we know the muscles are breathing and how the expansion of the chest occurs. Now we can start to talk about the gases that ventilate the lungs. And the only thing you have to recall from chemistry is Boyle's Law, or Charles Law, I can't remember which one. The law is, one thing to know is that now we're dealing with gases, not liquids, and that gases fill whatever chamber you inject them into. In this example here, this volume one exerts one atmosphere of pressure in this little piston they got here. But now they reduce the volume by half and it doubles the pressure. Okay? The gas molecules are just going to freely bounce around, exerting a pressure on the container you have them in, hence that equation. So you want to keep that in mind as we talk about air ventilating the lungs. And so the mechanics of breathing is that the physics of the lungs, airways, and chest wall, and how changes in lung volume create pressure gradients to move air in and out of the lungs. So the pressure gradient is the key. You make the pressure different inside the alveolar space, air will either flow in or flow out. That's the basic idea here. So here's all the things I need to define. I already defined this one, atmospheric pressure. That's the air you breathe. That's its pressure. Atmospheric pressure, we mostly talk about it as sea level in this class. I call it PATM. It's zero. It's our 0 point. I mean, if you want to put a true number to it, probably 760. And we already said the intrapleural cavity has a negative pressure, and that's the key. It does change, but it's always negative with respect to atmospheric pressure. Intrapleural pressure. I'll call it PIP for short, -4, or 756 millimeters of mercury. Okay. Now the pressure inside the alveolar space, inside the lung, I call intrapulmonary pressure. PPUL for short. Now that changes, okay? It could be zero, it could be -1, it could be +1 with respect to the atmospheric pressure. And the goal is to get it to change, -1, +1. You want to oscillate between that, because if you create a negative pressure inside the lung, air rushes in. Air rushes in until what? Until it equilibrates with that, zero. Then you want to take a breath out, create a positive pressure with respect to the lungs and with respect to the atmosphere, and basically then air rushes out. Air rushes out until, again, you equilibrate. So you're always equilibrating with atmospheric pressure. And so how we kind of quote-unquote calculate, it's not much of a calculation. You're just having a number and you're subtracting zero. We call that the transmural pressure, this equation at the bottom. Wait, we're rewriting here. The same transmural pressure as before, except now it's a different chapter, P trans. So applied to this lecture, transmural pressure is always pressure in minus pressure out. It's always the pressure gradient between two locations. So in this chapter, the pressure we'll be concerned about is the peephole, the pressure inside the alveolar space. So P trans, transmural pressure, equals P, PUL, intrapulmonary pressure, minus pressure of the atmosphere, pressure in minus pressure out. So just kind of put a picture to it. Just imagine the tiny spaces inside the lung. What's the difference across the whole system? The pressure of the air you breathe, what's the difference there? That's how air is going to come in and out. So now we have to teach the forces that change the shape of your chest, right? Expansion, collapse of the chest. And remember, lung is always stuck to the chest. Now, the lung is always an inward acting force. It always wants to collapse. If you break that seal, like with a wound, or it could happen spontaneously, your lung collapses. So that's why we say the forces are always inward. On the chest wall, they're always outward. Okay, remember what we wrote on the board at the beginning, right after the break, the lung holds the chest wall in, the chest holds the lung out. So here's what you need to know about lung forces, chest wall forces. Lung forces. I'll just put in to remind us they're always inward forces. The lung always wants to collapse. It doesn't naturally want to inflate, it naturally wants to deflate, like letting air out of a balloon. If you ever like blow a balloon up and let it go, does it ever inflate more? No, it always deflates, because that's the natural elasticity of the balloon wall. It's rubber and it wants to collapse. The lungs are like a balloon. They always want to collapse because they have a lot of elastic tissue around the alveolar spaces that makes it want to collapse, very much like a balloon. So the elastic recoil, because of all the elastic tissue, gives you quite a bit of force to overcome. This is basically, I think about this as, I want to inflate my lungs, I have to overcome this. The other thing is the surface tension. On the inside of an alveolar space is a tiny thin layer of water. Okay, they're lined with water. So that creates an air-water interface, because whenever you have, say, water in blue, the water molecules are attracted to each other more so than the alveolar wall. And when they do, it kind of creates a force in all the way around that wants to collapse. They call this the surface tension forces. You have to overcome that to inflate the lung. So elastic recoil, surface tension, let me spell that out. And sometimes I abbreviate elastic recoil and surface tension, EL and ST. I just want you to know when those terms are used what they come from. The elastic tissue and the little water lining on the inside. That's why the surfactants from the type 2 cells, it helps break that surface tension. That's why in premature births, that's one of the things they worried about. Are those type 2 cells there yet? If not, you gotta help administer these surfactants. Okay, chest wall forces. They're the opposite of this. There's no surface tension forces of the chest. The chest is basically your bony rib cage, a stiff tube, stiff conical tube. Basically what we say is the forces of the chest, it wants to like spring out. It's stiff, springs out, so the elastic recoil forces. Same idea, except that the force is in the opposite direction. It's not in, it's out. Now that's what you gotta know about the chest wall. It's very much like if you had springs pulling in the opposite direction. And that the two are not attached directly, but indirectly through fluid. That would represent the fluid in the pleural cavity. And so one spring is pulling this way. So the chest wall forces are the EL, but in this direction. The lung forces are EL and ST, but in this direction. So that breathing depends on the chest wall forces being greater than the lung. So it pulls it out. That expands the whole system and air rushes in. That's what happens during a breath in. So breathing has two parts, basically. You breathe in, you breathe out. And then there's the moment before you take the next breath. The average respiratory rate is about 15 breaths a minute. Okay. So then, lung wall forces are great, it pulls it the other way. So breathing in or breathing out is simply which forces are greater. Okay, and that's kind of what we gotta go to. This is what it looks like using a spring analogy, but I gotta teach it for real here. So let's consider the breathing cycle in three parts. This is basically the moment before you take a breath. FRC, I'll write it out later. This is more from the spirometry lecture. I'm not gonna do the balloon analogy. I'm gonna move right past that and just ignore that. But I put the arrows. Before you take a breath, nothing is moving, right? Your chest isn't expanding or collapsing. You're about to take a breath. And at that moment, these forces are basically the same. When you take a breath, chest wall forces are larger. They expand your chest, pull the lung out, air rushes in. So that when you take a breath out, muscles relax, the chest wall collapses, the lung wall forces are greater. Everything gets pulled in and air is pushed out. That's the basic idea. So how you need, what you need to know are, is how to use the P-trans equation. Okay, so let me kind of write on the board. Inspiration, expiration. Let's start with FRC, actually. So what we're going to do is apply the relationship of transmural pressure I'll call it P-trans for short and intrinsic forces acting on the lung. Intrinsic forces acting on the lung and chest wall. And we'll consider all of that while you breathe. And we'll start, before you take a breath, at something called FRC, which stands for functional residual capacity. I'll define it more in another lecture. Basically, when you take a breath out, you still have air in your lungs. If you take a normal breath out, I mean, can't you push a little more air out, like gasp? There's air there. And here's the thing, your lung is not collapsed. As long as your lung is not collapsed, there's a lot of air in there. There's a couple of liters, maybe 2.5 liters of air, even after you take the normal breath out. That air that is in your lungs before you take a breath is called functional residual capacity. It allows gas exchange to occur during the moment you don't breathe in, okay? It has a function. It allows gas exchange to always happen. You always have air in your lungs. Even if you gasp and forcefully push all the air out, and you're gonna do that in the lab, as long as your lung is not collapsed, there's still volume of air in the lungs. It's called the residual volume, the volume you can't get rid of unless your lung collapses. Anyways, during this time, before you take a next breath, here's the situation. P-trans equals pressure of the pressure intrapulmonary pressure, P-pull, minus pressure of the atmosphere. That's one equation we're going to look at. And the intrinsic forces of lung versus chest wall. And I define them as chest wall is the elastic forces, which are out, and the lung has elastic forces, ELST, and those are in. But nothing is moving at FRC, so these forces are equal. These are the intrinsic forces here. If the forces are equal, nothing moves. The other thing, how that relates to this is, during the moment before you take a breath, the atmospheric pressure is zero, and air inside the lungs has already equilibrated with the outside, so that pressure is zero. So again, not much math, but basically, when you calculate the difference, zero minus zero, zero, what that means is there's no gradient. So what that means is no air flows. No air flows. I'm just kind of setting the table for breathing. This is the moment before you breathe. So when you breathe, to expand the lungs, we need the expansive forces of the chest wall to be greater than the recoil forces of the lung. Just like if you have to blow up a balloon, the force of your breath has to be stronger than the elastic recoil of the balloon wall, otherwise you can't inflate it. If you're like me, you have weak lungs, what do you do to the balloon? You go like that, right? Because you're trying to reduce the elastic recoil of the balloon so you can inflate the balloon. So what has to happen for inspiration, let me write it up here. I'm going to say that inspiration is an active process, an active process. That means you recruit the muscles of inspiration right there. I would say 1 and 2 mostly, not so much 3. Recruit muscles. Diaphragm. And external intercostals. When you do that, the lung basically is pulled out because the chest wall will expand. you're going to increase thoracic volume. And as a result of that, you're going to decrease intrapulmonary pressure. So how I would note that in all this stuff is during inspiration, when you recruit the muscles, the chest wall forces become greater than the lung wall forces. That allows the chest wall to expand. And when you do that, you decrease the pressure inside the intrapulmonary space from 0 to -1. So -1 minus 0 is -1. So what will happen as a result of that, air will rush in to fill the vacuum. You breathe by negative pressure. Air rushes in. And basically, it'll keep rushing in until you equilibrate. Air rushes in until 0. Then it stops. So at the end of a breath in, stop right there. The pressure is 0. Okay. Let's kind of look at an animation of that PowerPoint. And here's basically what we got here. Here's my model of the airways with the lungs. So when you expand the chest, the lungs expand with it because they're stuck to each other. Okay, so when you make the space bigger, the intrapulmonary pressure decreases to -1, air rushes in until 0. Then you stop. Okay. So let's do the same thing, but take a breath out. Now, to take a breath out, it's a passive process. You don't need to recruit muscles. So for expiration, a passive process. You note to yourself that means no muscle recruitment. That's only for inspiration. For expiration, it's passive. Basically, the muscles relax, the chest and lung recoil. Muscles relax. When the muscles of the chest relax, the lung wall forces will be greater than the chest wall forces. That allows the lungs to recoil. They collapse. They recoil. Basically, what's going to happen is you're going to decrease thoracic volume, increase intrapulmonary pressure. Opposite, right? Shrink the space, increase the pressure. So, in the lungs, P-trans, I'm going to change that to a +1 - 0. Okay? Now we're positive with respect to atmospheric pressure. Now the gradient's the reverse. So what that means is, +1 is basically saying now air will rush out until 0. Air rushes out until it equilibrates and becomes 0, and then that's it, you stop breathing. I'll put another animation showing the same thing. Here's where we started. After a breath in, everything's inflated. Now we're going to take a breath out, or everything collapses. So when the system collapses, the space becomes smaller, the pressure becomes elevated a little bit to plus one, air rushes out until zero is reached and you equilibrate with the atmosphere. Now that's shown here on these graphs. I would pay attention mostly to top and bottom. Don't really pay attention to intrapulmonary pressure. The thing to take away from this blue curve, I said that's negative four. As you can see, it fluctuates. But the point is, it's always negative with respect to atmospheric pressure, and on average, it's negative four. Okay, but pay attention to that. Pay attention to that. That's a Thursday's lab. Breathe in, breathe out, and you're going to measure the volume of air your subject ventilates. So what I did was, I put like little green dots with the animation so you can kind of see how it works. Basically follow the green dot. All right, so take a breath in. The space gets bigger, the pressure decreases to negative one, right? But then air rushes in to fill the vacuum. Until what? You equilibrate. So at the end of a breath in, you equilibrate. So let's take a breath out. You shrink the space, and when you do that, you increase the intrapulmonary pressure into plus one. Okay? But then air rushes out as a result. Until you equilibrate to zero. So you always equilibrate to zero after a breath in, after a breath out. Always, always equilibrating with the environment. So it's easy to breathe if you have surfactants. You only need to generate a 1 to 2 millimeter mercury difference. Without surfactants, it will be much harder to breathe. I mean, if you have allergies like me and you're wheezing, you have to like generate more force, right? You have to generate more pressure gradients to draw air through in through an obstructed airway. So lung compliance is a good thing. Okay. Now I want to show you the bell jar. I should have got it real quick. Let me get it for you. It kind of like shows this in model form. Can't really have you do this because we only have two of them in the room. There's like 30 of them, but oh, drunk coffee. Put that there. All right. So what does this thing represent? What is this model? Diaphragm. And so the bell jar is actually probably thoracic cavity. The balloons obviously represent lungs. So you work this by just kind of pushing and pulling out. You see the balloons, how they inflate, deflate? Now when I pull down, they inflate. When I push in, they deflate. You increase the volume, you decrease the pressure, air rushes in. Okay, and you push out, they deflate because you decrease the volume, increase the pressure to push the air out. There's a hole, right? That's like your airway, right? You could demonstrate a pneumothorax if you kind of break the seal, so to speak. But that's kind of why that works. It works just by doing this on that principle. You change the volume. That changes the pressure inside the balloon. And it's the same with your lungs. The physics is the same. It doesn't change. Now, there are some factors that prevent airflow. And basically, it's summed up in this equation. Call this factors that are causing a resistance for air to flow. I'll write this equation on the board. F equals delta P over R. F is flow, R is resistance to airflow, and delta P is, we just talked about it, okay? Remember when we talked about how you change the P-pole, P-P-U-L, the intrapulmonary pressure to plus one or negative one? That's the delta P that will cause air to flow. The resistance is basically airway diameter. The question you ask yourself is, well, how, if it's smaller, if you decrease the airway diameter, that increases the resistance for air to flow through it. Okay? However, also consider how many airways. See if you're still awake. I know it's been long, but how many trachea do you have?
One.
And it's the largest airway, but you only have one. And then you start to divide. And we went through them all before the break, all the way to 23, 24. As the airways get smaller, the resistance increases because what's more of a factor is they're decreasing in size. There's not too many of them. By the third division, I said there's like 19 or 20 airways. But it quickly increases like to 10,000 and hundreds of thousands, and that's why the airway resistance drops, because even though the diameter is still shrinking, there's so many of them that the resistance to airflow drops. By the time you get down to the respiratory zone, there's no airway resistance. The air flows freely to your pink lungs, basically. We want lungs to be pink. Every time I open a cadaver, it's a 50-50 shot if there's black deposits. And we never know what it's from. We don't have an extensive enough case history. The students will always see it, and they'll be like, oh, smoker. Could be, but usually I think it's just dirty air. Living in LA, I think that could do it. You can physically see black deposits in lungs. It's very rare I see a completely pink lung. Okay, so there's stuff getting in there. But anyways, to know this, no resistance to air flow at the respiratory zone. Well, I guess one more thing to add is you could change this. Does anyone remember the names of the airways that can constrict and dilate? They got all the smooth muscle, no cartilage. The smallest of the bronchi are called bronchioles. Remember that? You can change this at the bronchial level. So bronchioles can affect this. If they constrict or dilate based on your autonomic nervous system. If they constrict / dilate. The neural control of respiration, I won't go too deep into it. It's kind of like how I did the baroreceptor reflex, but I won't go over all the centers. The basic thing you should understand is that these centers in your central nervous system, they're trying to regulate oxygen and CO2 levels. And the one that's tightly regulated is CO2, not oxygen. You might think oxygen is more essential to life. How come that's not more tightly regulated? It's because all the hemoglobin. You have so much oxygen bound to hemoglobin, The blood gases, you don't really worry about it. The CO2, you'll worry about, okay? Hypercapnia, too much CO2. Hypo, too little, okay? And it changes the breathing rate in response. Think arterial blood. Hyper, too much. You're increasing the CO2. Hypo. Decrease the CO2. Now here's an outline of it. Say the arterial CO2 increases. This says you increase the partial pressure of CO2, it decreases the pH, and you worry about the brain. Because the brain doesn't have any proteins to buffer changes in pH, so that's why we tightly control it. Now the different chemoreceptors, things in your body that can detect changes in blood gases, there's central ones, there's the peripheral ones. Okay? The central ones are in the medulla. The peripheral ones, like for example, they're basically in the same places as your baroreceptors, right? They go hand in hand. And the afferent impulses go to the medullary centers, and the efferent impulses will activate the muscles to increase ventilation, so you increase exhalation, re-regulating arterial CO2, okay? RR, my abbreviation for respiratory rate. So if it's too much, increase the breathing rate, breathe it off more. To decrease it. Hypocapnia, it gets too low. Maybe you're panicked. And when people panic, they start hyperventilating, and then they pass out. Because CO2 is actually a vasodilator in the brain. But what happens when you pass out, you stop breathing, that allows CO2 to accumulate and you're okay. You come back. You wake up. So if you see a person hyperventilating, sit them down, relax them, maybe have them rebreathe their own air from a paper bag, right, to help get their CO2 levels back up. So somehow maybe rebreathe, exhale there. To help, that will increase the CO2 so you don't pass out. So arterial blood, the number is 40 millimeters of mercury. That's the partial pressure of CO2 in the blood. And if that gets too high, it could drop the pH too much, and you worry about the brain, like I said. And so normally it's 40. If it reaches 45, you double your ventilation rate. 45 is what it's supposed to be in venous blood, not arterial blood. Okay, so something's going on there. Double the ventilation rate. And here's the hypocapnia. If you drop partial pressure of CO2, you get basal constriction in the brain. Like I said, you might pass out, stop breathing. That allows the CO2 to accumulate, which will wake you back up. Now, O2, not as regulated because you have a huge hemoglobin reservoir. I mean, what we'll learn in the gas exchange lecture tomorrow, I mean, even deoxygenated blood is still like 75% saturated. We'll get into that. So basically, you have to drop O2 to like 100 to 60 before you even notice an increase in ventilation. And also, when you breathe, you worry about the amount of fresh air that actually reaches deep inside the lung. We always teach students it's better to take a fewer deep breaths than many more shallow breaths, because you have to overcome the anatomical dead space. So let me define what that is. Dead space is kind of a misnomer. There's nothing dead. It's just dead space is the air you breathe in that actually doesn't reach the alveolar spaces for gas exchange. Dead space air. Air that does not reach the alveolar spaces. It's just going to sit in the conducting airways. It's not available for gas exchange. The stem of the flask representing the conducting zone. And then the bell of the flask representing the alveolar space, the respiratory zone where you can have gas exchange. So the air sitting in here, that's our dead space air. The air that reaches here is available for gas exchange. So every time you take a breath in, it's on average, it's about 500 ml fresh air. Of that 500 ml, maybe 350 reaches the alveolar spaces, and maybe 150 doesn't, and just will sit in the conducting airways. That's what I say here. So the amount that actually reaches alveoli is referred to as the alveolar ventilation rate. That 350. I usually call it AVR, but sometimes in physiology books, that V subscript A with a dot over it is the alveolar ventilation rate. If we reduce ventilation below that of dead space volume, there is no alveolar ventilation rate. Basically, you'll suffocate. For example, if a snorkeling tube had a volume of 350 and your anatomy is 150, that's 500. So theoretically, if you don't take a deeper breath than 500, there's no fresh air reaching the lung and you could suffocate. That's why never sit at the bottom of a swimming pool and breathe through a garden hose that's out. How come that doesn't work? Well, garden hose increases the dead space volume. Maybe the first breath through a garden hose is fresh air, then immediately after that, it's all stale air. There's no fresh air. So that's why that doesn't work. It's all about the dead space volume. Here's how you would calculate AVR. You have to basically subtract out dead space volume. So here's how it's done under three conditions. Sitting down, let's say dead space volume anatomically 150, tidal volume in the regular sitting down like you are, you breathe in the average 500 ml per breath. Your respiratory rate is the average 15 breaths a minute. That's how you calculate it out. So you first do it by going 500 minus 150, okay, gives me 350 ml. That's the amount of fresh air that reaches the alveolar spaces. So it's 350 ml per breath. Multiply that by the respiratory rate, 15 breaths per minute. You cross out the breaths, and you're going to get the appropriate 5,250 ml per minute. And that's kind of how you calculate it. And what you see from the math, you're ventilating the air, the lungs, much better with slow, deep, meditative type breaths versus shallow panic breathing. Okay? So that's why that's always preferable. There were some problems on the last slide. We can do them tomorrow. I wanted to end a little early. I have lecture exam 3 and lab practical 2 ready to let you review in class. If you'd like to see those, stay. If not, you're dismissed. I'll see you tomorrow.